We'd like to call up Dr. Sudha. She's a program director for Suvarna Arogya Suraksha Trust. It's an autonomous trust set up by the government of Karnataka to manage the three government-supported insurance schemes for tertiary care.
Good evening to one and all. I'm a medical doctor with a preventive medicine background and health economics. So currently working with the Suvarna Arogya Suraksha Trust in ensuring, I think, your dream of universal health coverage, especially in the tertiary sector as of now. So we have limited our programs. Whatever we are doing, the three schemes, the Vajpayee Arogya Shri scheme, the Rajiv Arogya Bhagya, and the Jyoti Sanjeevani schemes, for the tertiary care, and to reduce this 15.6% catastrophic expenses which many of the households you investigated had. So we cover conditions which lead to the maximum catastrophic expenditure for the family. I'm happy to be the last speaker. One of the main reason is, after hearing the kind of frustrations in the medical practice, the limitations of the current interventions, at least I can project some silver lining. Mainly to share that Karnataka is one of the first state to reach universal health coverage in the tertiary sector in India. So your dream of moving into the secondary sector and primary care is supposed to be. So these two are some things which we will definitely work on, with the RSDY being now transferred from the labor department to the health department. And especially in Karnataka, RSBY is being planned to be moved to our trust. So definitely there is something which we can really do in terms of the secondary care also. And some of the issues that were raised by the different panelists in terms of the care, the quality of care, the patient frustrations. So we had few very brainy minds when they formalized all these schemes. And some of the things we were able to address from the initial launch of the scheme. And one of the things was making it completely cashless. So for the patients, when they go and take services, they are completely cashless and no new ID cards. So there is no database generation, no waiting for the ID cards. But any individual, especially within the Karnataka, we have the BPL card. If they are below poverty, definitely they are supposed to have BPL card, because they have a lot of benefits they get with the BPL card. And along with that, we try to intervene the health benefits also. So we don't issue any new cards to anybody. So anybody having a BPL card, they take it and go to the hospitals who have been empaneled with our system, and they can access the services cashless if they find that it is a part of the 449 catastrophic procedures and conditions that we have listed, and they can take free service. So that is one, making it very simple, and having intersectoral coordination with the food and civil supply. So we have access to their database, and every hospital is completely on a computerized e-platform system. So sitting in a hospital, our staff can just log in to verify whether this BPL card is authenticated, genuine, reflecting the beneficiary details. So that is, we have made it as simple as that in terms of accessing services. And the second thing they pointed out is that the private sector is the main provider of services. So from the government right now, trying to set up a tertiary care center would take around another 20 years of trying to set up in every district, or in the medical colleges, where we are finding that there is medical college, but the level of hospital infrastructure is still very minimal, faculties are minimal. So in that, trying to set up huge cardiac units or tertiary sectors would take a lot of resources and time. So to cut short that, we have had a very good public-private partnership which we have built with the private providers and ensured their cooperation. And we have become the purchaser of services. So instead of the patient purchasing the service directly from these private providers, we act as intermediaries to especially limit all the other, the bad influences of purchasing from the private sector for a patient who doesn't know much about medical field. So definitely we act as the purchaser of services. So we have developed a well-defined packages. So that was one of the issues that was raised by your study, that, you know, patient doesn't know what treatment they have to take, what investigations have been done, is there an overuse or a misuse by the doctors. So definitely what we have done is, for every condition, what we care for in our scheme, we have well-defined packages and also the investigations. So you don't need to do 5 investigations, as you said, count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, why not 1? So what we have limited is, we have had a very good consultative group, the best in town, best in Karnataka, who are of each specialty, for the 7 specialties whom what we cater for, like the cardiology, the oncology, the polytrauma, the burns, pediatric surgeries, and urology, and all these specialties, we have had a consultative committee who have sat through us and defined these packages and said, this would be the one key diagnostic investigation I need to do if I have to ensure that the patient should be put on a procedure or should be given a treatment. So the minimum investigation required, maybe one is screening investigation and another is a confirmatory investigation. So those are the minimum limited investigation which the patient has to go through, and then he would be given the appropriate treatment based on a package. We don't just fix the package, what is the treatment plan, but we also fix the rate, so that, you know, the hospitals cannot collect more than what is fixed by the government for that procedure, which is done again based on the consultation and the kind of a costing of the few different procedures across hospitals, and whatever is the evidence available that this procedure minimally would cost this much. So that is one thing. And further, these hospitals, the other one reason is the quality of care will be always an issue. Okay, this is a free scheme, this is a cashless scheme, so the patients always worry, okay, will I get quality? Because, you know, anything given free, they feel that they might not get the best care. So to ensure that, when we empanel the hospitals in the government, we have 2 levels of screening. One is for the infrastructure itself, whether the hospital has all the infrastructure required. And the second thing is whether the doctors are of the required qualification and minimum experience. So that is one thing we try to ensure. Those 2 things which are key, the medical care is ensured. And further, the patient, the grievance redressal system is also very strong. With all this, definitely private hospitals have enough ways to, you know, milk the patients. Whether it is, they might milk the government also, ensure that they get the money from the government, but also maybe try to, you know, squeeze as much possible from the patient. So every time we give approval, the patient is called. We have a good strong call center. The patient is called, asked what he has paid already for any investigations or anything, and that is recorded. And once before we settle the claim, before the patient is discharged, any amount collected has to be refunded to the patient, and only then the claims are settled, or else the equivalent amount for the first offense is deducted from the claim. If the repeat offense is done, double the claim is deducted, and if it is a recurring thing, disciplinary action, including penalization of the hospital with regulatory authorities, is also done. So there's a very strong grievance reduction system we are doing. And I think the one more thing what I would like to say is that the standard treatment guidelines, especially for oncology, where you say that you can get a drug for an oncology drug for 500 rupees also, but the hospitals can also charge up to 50,000 for that drug. So that is a wide range of the cost of drugs that is available. We have a standard treatment guidelines for oncology, different cancers. What is the drugs that is known to have the best effect, which is cost effective and which can be provided to the patient, which will give the best care? So definitely, and those are the drugs that doctors can prescribe. They cannot go over and prescribe and over the counter, getting pharmacies, nothing like that. They have to purchase the drug and then give it free to the patient. No asking the patients to purchase any kind of drug. So we have tried to address one of your other finding also. And another thing is, you had asked whether the data is available to do these kinds of lot of studies, and what is, you know, what evidence we can get. So we have a very good software system because our whole operation is online from the time the patient enters the system till the patient claim is settled. So there's a huge data mine, and we do the analysis on a regular basis. So we had, like, for the past 1 year, how many cardiac stents were put? For the past 1 year, what were the surgeries which ranked high in different specialties? You know, what were the kind of issues that came with such cases? So we have a huge data mine, and we are able to look at the data and build up the evidence for our own improvement and learning, and also to have better practices for the medical care. So definitely these are some things which I feel that, yes, there is a silver lining with all the issues that is, you know, surrounding medical practice. And the same doctors who work in UK, USA, following all the standard protocols, when they suddenly return to India and we insist these, you know, standard guidelines and SOPs, they are surprised. Oh, I thought it would be much freer here. You know, the kind of systems and protocol are very stringent in the Western countries, but they find it very difficult to adapt to the similar systems, especially when in India it's trying to be, you know, established. So we are starting into that, and UHC is something which will definitely, you know, pick up in the next few years, and I think we should make every effort to ensure that the systems are there. Some stray incidents here and there, I know there's a lot of things also coming up. There are few stray incidents which do get the media attention and everything. But till now we have treated around 91,000 beneficiaries for catastrophic illnesses. So definitely the level of serious severity they come in, especially when they take care, so is very high. So there is bound to be some kind of morbidity and mortality for that group of patients, and that should be taken with a background of proper evidence, not just saying that, okay, there is always a negligence in every case of mortality or every case of morbidity that might follow a procedure. So with this, I would like to, you know, conclude saying that, you know, you also have a smile when you go out of this room. Not only look at, you know, there are so many issues, but have a smile that there is something which the government is doing and trying to do, and your cooperation is very much needed for you to exercise that right. Because I still feel many people don't know about our scheme. They still go pay up and take services. So ensure that your hospital, before going, your nearest hospital is empaneled. Ask them whether, you know, you can be under the scheme for this procedure, and ensure that you take that services. So the patient also need to exercise the right given to them. So that is a key point. Make use of this, have a BPL or APL or a government employee card, whatever is available. Ensure that you use it and take the best of the services. Thank you.